Hello and welcome to my channel, Medicine with Dr. Moran. The journal The Lancet recently published a systematic review and meta-analysis on natural immunity, now 3 years into the pandemic. They took a look at 65 studies from 13 different countries. This, of course, has been a taboo subject, but finally it's been getting more light shed on it over the past year. I've published an extensive playlist of studies over the last 2 years on the subject as data has been published. It's something that I've been frequently asked about by patients, friends, and family. Now, natural immunity, this refers to the condition where someone, through no fault of their own, acquires an infection, survives, and makes antibodies as well as memory cells against the infection, which provide protection against reinfection from the same virus. Now, obviously, there's survivorship bias, as not everybody survives the initial infection. Now, with respect to SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19, there is highly variable risk when it comes to severe disease that leads to hospitalization or even death. I've reported extensively about risk in regards to the different age groups as well as comorbidities on my channel. Now, perception of risk has been poorly articulated in the media, which led me initially to be making videos, as fatality rates were quoted in the 2 to 10% range, which were grossly misleading, when the real infection fatality rate for everyone with no immunity was much lower, on the order of 0.25%, as reported by the US CDC. This figure, of course, is markedly higher for people over the age of 80 with comorbidities and no immunity, which can be 5% or even more, but it's markedly lower in healthy people under the age of 30. A German study showed no deaths in children from 5 to 11. So there's quite a significant gradation of risk even in non-immune people. And by non-immune, I mean people that have not been vaccinated or infected. Many people, not to mention political figures, either overestimated or underestimated the risk of severe disease. That's where physicians could have been quite helpful advising people of their actual risk and trying to get people to be healthy. So why is natural immunity important? Well, this is something that our bodies deal with on a regular basis. We get respiratory infections from many different viruses on a regular basis. We develop antibodies to these viruses, which ultimately wane with time, but we also develop cellular immunity from our memory B and T cells, which in the case of many viruses, allow us to fend off viral infections even years later, preventing us from ending up in the hospital or even dying. As the antibodies wane, protection against reinfection with symptoms only lasts a short duration, typically months, and we can get reinfected by the same virus all over again, but the protection against severe disease can last much longer. This is simply how our immune system works. It's what we learn in medical school. Every physician knows this. Every student learning immunology learns this. This is why it's difficult to understand why this whole concept of natural immunity was ignored by many countries. As this virus, of course, spread out through the world, many people, through no fault of their own, happened to get infected. It might have been you. This is simply a fact of life when we have very transmissible respiratory viruses. You can't shame people for picking up infections, which unfortunately is what happened in many cases. And physicians cannot ignore their patients or not treat them just because they got infected. It's our duty to care. We knew early on people who got infected did not seem to be getting reinfected. In other words, they had some degree of protection. Now, with each virus, understanding natural immunity is important so that we understand what kind of protection previous infection gives to people. If the protection is significant, then these people might not need to be vaccinated if a vaccine becomes available. Or at least they could have lower priority for vaccination while other people who are non-immune get vaccinated first. That was something that was lost in this particular pandemic. It was not even considered by many countries. Now, vaccine passports that allowed people to move freely were only given in some countries to people with antibodies against the vaccine, but completely ignored the antibodies that were generated by natural infection. It seemed bizarre to me that governments would accept the antibodies made by the vaccines, which were only to the spike protein, of course, but were ignoring antibodies made to the real virus through natural infection, which of course were broader because people who were naturally infected did not just develop antibodies against the spike protein, but they also developed antibodies against the rest of the virus. So what did the Lancet systematic review tell us? Well, here's the study. And of course, as always, there's a link to the study in the description below if you're interested. The background statement in their summary I thought was interesting because this was ignored by many countries. And they state, understanding the level and characteristics of protection from past SARS-CoV-2 infection against subsequent reinfection, symptomatic COVID-19 disease and severe disease is essential for predicting burden, for designing policies that restrict travel or access to venues where there's high risk of transmission, and for informing choices about when to receive vaccine doses. To summarize the results, they looked at these 65 studies from 19 different countries, and they reviewed protection against the original or ancestral strain, as well as Alpha, Beta, Delta, and the initial Omicron variant. As I reported on the channel, protection from reinfection declines over time, and at 40 weeks, they found protection from reinfection from the original Alpha and Delta variants was 78%. But protection against reinfection by Omicron declined much more rapidly and was 36% at 40 weeks. The more important data is what is the protection against severe disease? This remained high for all variants at 90% for the original Alpha and Delta variants and 89% for Omicron at 40 weeks. Their summary statement was that immunity conferred by past infection should be weighed alongside the same protection that you might get from vaccination when assessing future disease burden. It provides guidance on when individuals should be vaccinated, and designing policies that mandate vaccination, workers, or restrict access on the basis of immune status to settings where the risk of transmission is high, such as travel or indoor settings. They also state that although protection from reinfection from all variants wanes over time, our analysis of the available data suggests that the level of protection afforded by previous infection is at least as high, if not higher, than that provided by two doses of the vaccine using a high-quality mRNA vaccine, Moderna and Pfizer. I and others have been making all of these points for a long time, and of course, this is just simply basic immunology 101. But obviously, with any new virus, one must do the research to understand the specifics of natural immunity as well as immunity from vaccination. The general public do need to understand the word immunity is not the absolute or what we call sterilizing immunity, where if someone gets infected or is vaccinated, that they will never ever get the disease. In addition, people who are currently well protected against this virus will have their immunity wane over the years or decades. And it's highly likely that they may not get severe disease now, but when they get into their older years or if they become immunocompromised, this virus could cause severe disease or even death down the road. The vast majority of the world has been infected by this virus at this point, and of course many people have been vaccinated as well. It's interesting to me to note that the United States still does not allow visitors who are unvaccinated. This policy, of course, has led to some high-profile people not being able to visit, such as the world number one tennis player, Novak Djokovic, who has been infected at least once that I'm aware of. So this systematic review tells you that his natural immunity is at least as good, if not better, as two vaccinations. But people who have had two vaccinations can enter the United States, whereas he cannot. Many spectators, in fact, in the stands in the tennis world have never been vaccinated, and of course they're allowed to attend the tournament. I'm not sure whether other countries are still doing the same as the United States. Please comment below if this is still the case in your country. I would be interested to know. Thanks a lot for watching my presentation today. Remember, get healthy and stay healthy.